Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. This is what you will hear on today's program. Jill Robbins has a report on a Chinese company's humanoid robots. Dan Friedell reports on a blood sugar device athletes are using to improve performance. Caty Weaver tells about scientists' hunt for small stars, planets, and conditions for life. Then Caty tells us about a special word in the report. We wrap things up with the lesson of the day. Here is Jill.
Engineers at the Chinese company X Robots are developing human-like robots at a factory in China's northeastern coastal city of Dalian. Their goal is to increase the ability of the company's robots to show facial expressions and emotions. Robot body parts like arms, feet, and heads are spread out around the factory. The parts are made from a soft, movable material called silicone. And human-like robots in different stages of construction can be found nearby. Drawings of robot designs are on a wall. Lee Bo-young is X Robot's chief executive. He said, "We have our own software and algorithm teams." Algorithms are commands or rules that a computer program follows. Robots need them to operate. Lee said, "There are many basic models and algorithms that are commonly open source, which everyone uses. Open source programming is usually freely available to software developers to use in their systems." But Lee said that his company is centering its efforts on how to get the artificial intelligence, or AI, to recognize and express expressions and emotions. In a demonstration, for example, an X-Robot's worker moved her head, smiled, and stuck out her tongue. A human-like robot then copied her movement using small motors placed in several spaces in its head. Lee said, "We are also working on the foundation model. The model we're making is multimodal and capable of emotional expression. Multimodal AI can process different kinds of signals and can react to them. For example, a multimodal system could react to video, text, sound, or touch." Lee added that it can examine the surrounding environment and produce correct facial feedback. X Robots said it takes from 2 weeks to a month to produce a humanoid robot. The robots cost from $207,000 to $276,000. So far, the robot's main purpose is to be shown in museums. One of the museums is in the same building as the X Robots factory. Looking ahead, Lee believes human-like robots will have a bigger part to play in the healthcare and education industries. He said that mental health treatments, like psychological counseling, are ways these robots will be used in the future. He added that his company is currently researching treatments and information gathering for mental health disorders. Lee said, "Moreover, I believe that emotional interaction has broader applications in service fields, such as those aimed at children." I'm Jill Robbins.
Thank you.
Medical device companies Abbott and Dexcom make small devices that attach to the skin and monitor the amount of glucose or sugar in the blood. These devices were first made to help people with diabetes. Diabetes is a medical condition that prevents the body from properly digesting sugar and turning it into energy. The devices permit people to make changes to their diet or take medication, such as insulin, to help control their glucose levels. But the devices are also being used by some Olympic athletes. The monitors help runners and swimmers learn how the food they eat affects their energy level. Dutch long-distance runner Abdi Njai is paid to wear a device made by Abbott. Njai was the silver medal winner at the Tokyo Olympics. He will try to get another medal during this summer's Olympics in Paris, France. The games begin on July 26th. Njai pays attention to his sleeping and eating each day, so it makes sense that he would pay attention to the sugar in his blood. That's your energy, actually. That's your fuel. We have to monitor that, said Njai. The information that comes from the monitor helps Njai get closer to an effortless or stress-free run. The devices are called continuous glucose monitors, or CGMs. In the past, they required a prescription from a medical doctor, but now, although there is no official proof that the devices help with athletic performance, the companies that make them are getting permission to sell them to regular people. I do see a day where a CGM is certainly going to be used outside of diabetes in a big way, said Dexcom's chief operating officer Jacob Leach. In March, the U.S. gave Leach's company permission to sell its Stilo device without a prescription. It is expected to go on sale this summer. Abbott pays Kenyan marathoner Eliud Kipchoge to wear its device. He has won the last two Olympic marathons. He uses the device to monitor his calories and the intensity of his workouts. Abbott said its device, called Libre Rio, will also be available soon without a prescription. Both companies saw sales growth of over 20% for their wearable CGMs for diabetes patients in 2023. A research company called Global Data sees the growth continuing at a rate of 15% per year through 2031, as more people become interested in using the devices to help with weight loss. Sports researcher Philippe Larson sees the CGMs as a way to better understand the exertion levels of serious athletes. Larson is a professor at the Swedish School of Sport and Health Sciences. A big guesswork for endurance athletes has always been, am I training hard enough or am I training too hard? It seems with CGMs, we have a better understanding, he said. Larson also works with a company called Svexa, which researches sports performance. He has already examined CGM data from some athletes and sports teams. Larson notes there is little proven science about how to help athletes perform better using the data that comes from the monitors. Most researchers cannot give you the exact answers. In 5 years, we will know 10 times as much as we do now, he said. But the possibility of finding important data means many people are looking into monitoring blood glucose. Greg Cox is a sports dietitian and associate professor at Bond University in Australia. He works with swimmers, rowers, and track and field athletes. Cox said a recent test of top athletes proved inconclusive. The test restricted an athlete's calories before an intense exercise session. He and Larson said they were unsure how valuable a CGM would be for a regular person who used it without medical supervision. But for the companies that make the devices, the non-medical market is large. Abbott says it believes the CGMs will help people lead healthier lives with improved energy, mood, focus, sleep. I'm Dan Friedell.
Stars about the size of our sun are not the most common ones in the Milky Way galaxy. Much smaller stars are far more common. Of all the stars in our galaxy, these small stars host the most planets. Scientists are studying the planets of these small stars in the search for worlds that may support life. New research is providing understanding about how planets form around these small stars, called very low mass stars, or VLMS. The chemistry of the planet-forming disks of gas and dust surrounding them is different from similar disks observed around stars like the Sun. The James Webb Space Telescope has gathered data on a planet-forming, or protoplanetary, disk around a newborn star called ISO CHAL 147. It is only about 11% of the Sun's mass. Its diameter is about 43% of the Sun's, and its luminosity is about 2% of the Sun's. Luminosity is a measure of electromagnetic radiation. ISO CHAL 147 is about 625 light years from Earth. A light year, the distance light travels in a year, is 9.5 trillion kilometers. Webb's observations showed that the gas in this star's protoplanetary disk is rich in carbon with no evidence of water. This differs from new sun-like stars, which have oxygen-rich gas and a lot of water vapor in their disks. Scientists wonder if this difference could influence the future habitability of rocky planets that form around these small stars. A planet mainly requires, among other things, water to be in liquid state and have a suitable atmosphere for it to be habitable, said astrophysicist Aditya Arabavi of the University of Groningen in the Netherlands, who was the lead writer of the study published recently in Science. Although we can expect that the different environment of VLMS disks would have a strong influence on the planetary composition and thus the habitability, it is difficult to predict whether this makes it less likely to be habitable, Arabavi said. Stars form when dense areas of gas and dust collapse under their own gravitational pull. Once a star appears at the center of such a cloud, the remaining material forms into a turning disk around it. This activity feeds star growth and often leads to the formation of planets. The disks around very young sun-sized stars contain much more material than those around smaller stars. This means the larger stars are more likely to have gas giant planets form around them. This is the case with the Sun and its planets Jupiter and Saturn. VLMS are the most common stars in our Milky Way, said astrophysicist and study co-writer Thomas Henning of the Max Planck Institute for Astronomy in Germany. These objects are presently the targets in the search for rocky planets because they are easier to find around such stars. In addition, the masses of their planet-forming disks are in general too small to form giant planets, but large enough to form rocky planets, Henning said. Scientists have already identified rocky planets orbiting very low-mass stars, including some that orbit at the right distance to support life. I would expect that the planets would remain habitable if they are located in the zone where liquid water can exist, Henning said. Still very young, ISO CHAO 147 may become a kind of very low-mass star called a red dwarf. The star's diameter is only about 4 times greater than Jupiter's. Our Sun's diameter is about 10 times larger than Jupiter's. Webb, which began operating in 2022, also identified ethane in ISO CHAO 147's protoplanetary disk. The discovery marks the first time the gas has been found outside our star system. The research also found other carbon gases never before observed in such a disk. Webb is certainly helping us by providing invaluable data that was never possible before, Arabavi said. I'm Caty Weaver.
And now we have Caty here with us. Welcome, Caty.
Hi, Mario. Thanks for having me on the show.
In today's report, you used one adjective repeatedly. Can you guess the word I'm talking about?
Yep. I think you are talking about habitable. Am I right?
You've got it.
Well, I'm happy you brought it up because it is a useful word. I also think it is a fun word to say. It kind of sounds like someone running up or down a few steps.
And what does it mean?
Habitable describes an environment that can support life. Space scientists are looking for places in the universe, including planets, that might have the right conditions for human settlement. And a habitat is the usual place an animal or plant lives. It is the environment that supports the animal or plant's continued existence.
Well, thanks for the report, Caty. We're looking forward to hearing from you a lot more in future shows.
It was my pleasure, Mario.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Ana Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In lesson 45 of the series, Ana and her roommate go on a road trip to see famous places in the United States. And their plan is ambitious.
Ambitious, that's spelled A-M-B-I-T-I-O-U-S, means that a plan or goal is on a large scale or perhaps difficult to do. Ana and Marcia hope to see famous places all over the U.S. So their plan is ambitious because the U.S. is very large. To see all the things they want to see, they will be traveling for weeks.
That's true. They plan to drive north from Washington, D.C. to New York City, and then head west all the way to California.
So that's what we call a coast-to-coast trip, all the way from one ocean to the other, in this case, from the Atlantic to the Pacific. That's a trip of almost 4,000 kilometers.
And then they have to drive back. I guess we could call that a coast-to-coast-to-coast trip.
I never thought of it that way, but I guess you're right.
Let's listen to Ana and Marcia talk about some of the things they will be seeing.
Hi, Marcia.
Hi.
I packed my bags and I am ready to go.
Did you make a list of all the places you want to see?
I did. I want to see New York City and the Statue of Liberty.
And I want to see Mount Rushmore.
Mount Rushmore.
And don't forget the Grand Canyon.
Let's not forget California's Redwood Forest. There are so many places to see.
We will be driving for a long time, so we might get bored.
Bored? No way. We can talk.
Or not talk.
We can play word games. We can sing. You know, Marcia, our trip is like that famous American song. This land is your land. This land is my land.
From California to New York Island.
From the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me.
Marcia and Ana were singing the song called This Land is Your Land. It was written by an American folk singer named Woody Guthrie in 1940. Guthrie wanted to express the idea that the U.S. should offer equal opportunity and rights to every person in the country.
Great idea. Now, let's see if their trip gets off to a good start.
Will we be stopping soon?
We won't be stopping soon.
I'm hungry.
Marcia, we just left D.C. We'll be eating lunch in about 2 hours. Can you wait?
I guess.
Here, have an apple. It's organic.
Thanks.
Unfortunately for Marcia, Ana accidentally throws the apple out of the window of the car. So Marcia will have to wait a little longer before she can eat.
She will have to wait, but our listeners can notice right now a special way we can talk about the future in English. It's called the future continuous tense. Listen again.
Marcia, we just left D.C., we'll be eating lunch in about 2 hours.
Instead of saying, we're going to eat in 2 hours, Ana says,
we'll be eating lunch in about 2 hours.
That's because it takes some time to eat. For actions in the future that take some time to do, we can use the modal will plus the verb be plus the main verb with ing. For example, listen to this exchange.
What will you be doing tomorrow afternoon?
I'll be working from noon until 6 p.m.
We often use the future continuous when we specify, or say, the amount of time we expect the activity to take. If we don't know or care about the length of time, then we can just use the expression going to, like in this exchange.
Do you have any plans for the weekend?
I'm going to try to clean my room and maybe go to a movie.
Here, the speaker either does not know or does not care about expressing how long the actions will take.
Now listen to this part of Lesson 45 and see if you can hear the future continuous tense. How many times do you hear it used? Listen carefully.
We will be entering North Dakota any minute now.
North Dakota? We are going in the wrong direction. We want to go to South Dakota.
No problem. I will just exit the highway. We will be going south in just a minute. There, done. We're going south. Okay, we will be stopping for gas and a bathroom break in about an hour.
Anna used the tense 3 times.
We will be entering North Dakota any minute now. We will be going south in just a minute. Okay, we will be stopping for gas and a bathroom break in about an hour.
And most native speakers join together the 2 words we and will with the contraction. Instead of saying we will, people say we'll.
We combined the subject and the word will together. Like this, I'll, you'll, he'll, she'll, we'll, and they'll. Now, let's listen to one more quick example from Lesson 45.
Okay, we will be arriving in New York City very soon.
I can't wait to see the Big Apple.
You can hear the future continuous when Marcia says, we will be arriving. She expresses an expectation about the time by using the word soon. Also, we should note that the Big Apple is a nickname for New York City. Other cities in the U.S. have nicknames too.
Chicago is called the Windy City because its politicians talked so much. Detroit is called the Motor City because many American cars and trucks are built there. And Denver is called the Mile High City because it is about 1 mile, or 1,600 meters, above sea level.
It's fun to learn the nicknames of cities. I grew up in a city they called the Crossroads of America. Listeners, what are the nicknames of some cities or towns in your country? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com and let us know.
And now, before we go, here's one last example of the future continuous. This is from a song written in 1938, and it uses the future continuous in its title. It's a song about seeing people again, after you have missed them. Jill, do you know what song I'm talking about?
I think I do. Is it I'll Be Seeing You?
It sure is.
Are you going to sing it for us?
Maybe just the first part, so our listeners can get the idea. It goes like this. I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. A little high for me.
And we'll be seeing you, in a sense, soon on the next lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Thanks for listening. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.